Okay, hi. I hope everyone can hear me all the way to the back. Do I need this? Can you guys hear me without the mic on the way? On the last bench, yeah? I'm not going to use the mic because it saves me a lot of fidgeting. Cool, shall we begin? Okay, so my name is Kashif, K-A-S-H-I-F. I work at Kayako. I'll tell you a little bit about what Kayako is so that you understand the problem space. And we'll be talking about immutable infrastructure. It is what it is and what good it does. So let's begin. Okay, so a couple of things I'll cover in this talk just to set context, right? This is not, fortunately, it's not a hypothetical talk. This is not, oh, this is a good idea, you should do it, I haven't done it. This isn't that, we've done this, it runs in production. So it's a real life case study. Can you guys read the text? Because is it too, you know, like, it's too light. So what I... Is it any better now? No. Can you guys come forward? I have a lot of seats here. So some of you guys come forward. I think that's one part of that. If you can't read it and you want to read it, come forward. Sorry? Can we switch off this light? Yeah. Cool. Perhaps. Sorry, get switched off. Okay. So I'm not going to read these points out. So this is a real life case study. This is stuff that we've already done. It's not a hypothetical thing. It's not just gyan. We'll talk about architecture, right? And I'll do it without diagram because I want to talk at a conceptual level. I'm not going to show you a complicated or simple diagram for you to understand. You should be able to understand this just by talking about it. We'll talk about clearly what is immutable infrastructure, which is the core essence of this talk. We'll talk about, people say infrastructure is code. So we'll talk about that. We'll talk about a tool that enables that. We'll talk about these key problems, that is infrastructure, secret management, service discovery, container management and scheduling, blue-green deployments, and we'll also talk about how we've used AWS to kind of help enable all of this and make it easy for us, okay? Any better? Okay, great, thank you. Cool. So does everybody get what this talk is about? So a couple of questions you shouldn't ask. You can ask me a question at any time, but I think the format is generally towards the end of the talk. Couple of questions you shouldn't ask me, right? You shouldn't ask me, oh, I've got this. What is the code I need to write to do this, right? That's very tactical. The talk is not for that, right? I'm happy to answer those talks. So is my team, which is the awesome team that's kind of done all this work. They're right here. So they'll be happy to talk to you afterwards if you need, you know, very specific answers, stuff at the code level or at a very, tactical level. This is an overall talk to give you an overall idea. After this talk, you should be able to walk away and say, I see this is what we can do, at our own processes, with our own processes, with our own tech, and this is how we can evolve our DevOps further, right? So that's what you should walk away with. So quickly, what is Kayako? You need to know that so that you understand what we did because this is a real life case study, and so the case study here is the company itself. So Kayako is a helpdesk software, and it's very much like Zendesk or Freshdesk. If you heard of any of those, it's a similar product. It helps companies, run their support teams. Right? So I'll give you an example of that quickly. So this is one customer of ours called Sindori. Right? This is their website. They build Mac apps, and so they have this support link here, right? And you've seen this support link on all websites, right? And this feeds into some piece of software, right, which is either us or Zendesk or Freshdesk or any of the other APIs. So when you click on on that support link, you'll end up here. This is Kayako. Okay? So this is the customer facing view of Kayako. There's also an agent facing view where people send in support questions. They call, they send messages to the support team and the agents answer those. So there's an agent side as well, I'm not showing you that, but that's essentially what Kayako does, right? So this is a snapshot of a knowledge center. So this is where people would come, ask questions of the search, essentially, see if there's an article that can answer their question. If not, then they can engage with a messenger bot or, they can drop an email to customer support or call or whatever it is, right? So that's what Kayako does. Okay, we'll start by talking about what we did before we did this and what problems we had. So what was our life before Immutable infrastructure, right? And I think a lot of us will be able to kind of relate with that and how sucky that was. So what would happen is when somebody came to Kayako, right, they would go and click on this. This is the website screenshot. They would click on this link called Start Your Free Trial. Right? So you click on this link and instantly you would kind of get a trial that you could use yourself. So a fully installed version of Kayako on a subdomain. So, your Kayako.com or something like that. And you could just go ahead and play around and understand the thing. And if you liked it, you could just go ahead and change the billing to pay. And you build your instance of Kayako and start using it. So what would happen is, in order for you to understand how our processes have been affected, I'm going to pick one thing that used to do, which is provisioning a trial, right? So when you click on this button, you fill out a form, and then basis on that form, we provision a trial for you. So if your company is called InvestorPad, once you fill out that form, you'll tell us your company name, and then we'll at the end, when you click submit, you'll get InvestorPad.kayako.com. Will become a help center like this, right? So this is Sindori. This is basically Sindori.kayako.com that they have, white labeled to support.sindori.org. Okay? So everybody clear what would happen when you click on a trial, right? So how would a trial get made, right? What would be the processes that would kick in to get a trial made on the fly? So we get a request, a post request from a form, right? So essentially that would come in, get submitted. Then we had this app which we called, it's a legacy app, but it was called Platform. Okay, it's a pathetic name, but that's what it was called. So Platform would receive this form, right, this form submission. It would get a list of all the servers that are out there, right, that we're currently using. And we were running on SoftLayer, not on AWS at this point, right? So SoftLayer was, as some of you might know, is a traditional data center, right? It's not a cloud data center. You get physical machines, you put them in racks. So Platform was the app that managed all the infrastructure. So it would know what are all the servers that have been registered with it. So it would get a list of all servers, right? And then it would make a copy of the latest code for this guy, for InvestorPad, let's say that's the, that's the customers trying out and getting a free trial made. It would make a copy of that code in a separate directory and then set up an Nginx rule to kind of send traffic to that. So it was not really multi-tenant, right? Every tenant had his own directory, right? Which is not ideal, but that's the way it was. Then it would update the configuration for that tenant, right? So it would say, this is a free plan, etc., etc. This is the database details, so on and so forth, right? Whatever configuration is required to run it. And then from each of these servers, so imagine 20 servers, right? So this is happening on all 20 servers. A new directory is being made, new code is being put, an Nginx rule is being set to kind of route to that code, and this was on PHP. And then all of these servers would send an ACK back, right? And we'd use the MQP to send that ACK back. That ACK would go back to the platform saying, I'm done. When all 20 are done, right? When everybody is done, then we can go to the next step, which is essentially the next step is we'll pick them one of these 20 servers to execute a product setup. A product setup would create database tables and put in some sample data and things like that. Right? So you can imagine what would happen, right? When 20 servers are involved, all kinds of load, you sent a request to 20 servers, only 18 requests came back, so the trial is stuck. So the guy who's waiting, who's thinking, should I pay money for this, is now thinking I should not pay money for this, right? Because it's not going well, he's stuck, we're waiting. And then when you eventually receive all the 20 acts, you go ahead and the process is complete and you get your trial, right? So the last step in that process is we need to make DNS entries, right? So we have to say investorpad.kayako.com must now point to our load balances so that the traffic can be directed onto Nginx from which it goes into that directory that we talked about, right? process is kind of important to get, right? Because then you'll see how does this change, right? And what we do now and how it's different. So remember, we were on software. They keep that in the back of your mind. So, you know, if you had to provision hardware, how would we do it at that time? So we would write a ticket, which is an email somebody would send to software. They say, okay, we will add a new server. So they'll go check the rack. Somebody physically would go and check the rack and say, yes, this rack has space, right? Or they'll have some register and they'll check. Say, yeah, and there's a server there. Good. Your lucky day, 24 hours, you get a server. Right? Unlucky day, they say, oh, your rack is full. And so we need to put it on a different rack. Right? And we don't have a spare rack, so we've sent an order for a new rack, or we're picking one up from our godowns or whatever. So it'll not take 1 day, but 2 or 3 days for your server to come up. So that was the life before cloud, right? Once we got this hardware, we would go ahead and provision this by hand essentially, or we'll use things like Chef, right? So, you know, you get some of your software installed, you know, make sure that everything is properly set up. So that would happen all by hand. And then we had various kinds of servers, right? So we had load balancers, application servers, worker servers, so on and so forth, some 7-8 types of servers that one needed to set up. So you have some kind of recipe usually in your head, otherwise, if you're lucky as a chef recipe, at least partially, and then you'd use that to kind of set up these servers, right? So if I was setting it up or if somebody else was setting it up, it might turn out differently. Because, you know, depends on how much you remember or whether your chef recipe covers that. That used to happen all the time. And then after you've done that, you have to test it. Because, you know, you had to tell no one that you had to test the server, because everybody was underconfident that the server was provisioned correctly. So everybody felt, I have to test it to figure out whether it's working. Well, after you did the task, you felt so underconfident about having completed it, you would test it. So people would manually test this, see 8 or 10 code paths, see if everything is working properly. If I send a packet to AMQP, it doesn't come back, right? They'll do all that kind of stuff. So that was what manually done. And then after all of this is done, we'll go and tell our legacy platform app, right? That, hey, listen, we have a new server. This is of this type, keep a record. So when you install new software, make sure you do it. So there are all kinds of failure points. If you see, everything was fairly manual. Some of it was automated, but very, very different. Just to give you a flavor of all the stuff that we were using back then, right? So PHP, as you know, is not concurrent, right? So you can't do two tasks at one time. You can only do one thing, right? So what the PHP ecosystem does is that they put a job in on any job queue, right? To do anything concurrently. And then somebody picks it up from the job queue and executes it, right? So Bootstrap D was our local job queue that would run on that box. Essentially, any concurrent task, any long-running task would be deferred to it, right? And then we had AMQP if we needed to kind of communicate between boxes or send messages between boxes. You know, we use Elasticsearch, we use Redis, we use MySQL. And for DNS, we use Dynamic, right? Because Dynamic had an API for us to kind of do all of this easily. Now, this is a busy slide. I'm not going to read it out, but what's wrong with this? So I think it should be fairly apparent what is wrong with this, but I'm not going to take you guys through it nonetheless. Stuff was not consistent, right? If I provisioned a server today, and then I provisioned another app server, say 7 days from now or 2 months from now, right? It's possible that the PHP version that was stable has changed, right? The app repository that I was using has updated that, right? It's possible that nobody's taking the trouble to kind of correct that in Chef. So it's possible that it appears to me that while I'm running through Chef, everything is actually not consistent because I'm running two different, say, minor versions of PHP or some other software, right? So that's an example of that. There are a lot of ways you can be inconsistent. So stuff would be inconsistent. What's wrong with this one? We have to make a, yeah.
I just would like to make a point here that
it's not a problem of the tool itself. Because it's not a problem of the tool, it's the problem of the environment, right? The culture, the setup, the processes that we have in place. So one of the challenges with things like Chef is, right, it allows you not to use it, right? And so everybody does that. So they say, oh, itna automation, I'll install Nginx through Chef because, you know, I'll find a simple cut, copy, paste recipe. Life is simple. I can do that. But if you want to do something custom, right, then I'll go back, right? And nobody can prevent you from taking that path. That's one of the problems that these tools have. And we eventually went to a model where that was not a problem. So I'll share that in a little bit. But the problem is not with the tool, really. The tool, if you use it well, it will kind of work well. But the problem with this, the setup that we have. You know, another problem was we needed a copy of code every time. So if you made a new trial, you need to provision a fresh copy of code. Possibility with that was that it is possible for a DevOps guy to now go in and change that code for a particular customer, and you know he gets actually different version of the product than what you're getting in real life, and you'll be what everybody else is getting, and you'll be surprised this is actually a common case. So what happens is, oh, this customer's got a lot of load, a lot of problem. Can we relax this limit for him? And that limit is not configured. It's just like a default limit built into the product. So somebody would just go in and change it in their directory, right? And now you've got drift. So this kind of stuff would happen over time. Updating system software was extremely difficult, so no one really updated it. But if you've got to update it now, you've got to take that server down one at a time, go in, run chef or manually update it or whatever else. And it was a painful process. It was not truly multi-tenant, I've covered. Secrets were kept in a chef data bank. Right? So if I had a token for, say, SendGrid or some other third-party provider that I was using, that token would be put in a chef data bank and then chef could ship it to those servers. And then it would be lying on disk on those servers. Right? So the moment that server got compromised, all of those tokens are compromised. Right? So that's not good secret management. People had SSH access. They needed SSH access because they wanted to go in and modify stuff. They had to provision stuff manually. Right? If chef failed, I had to figure out why chef failed, all of that stuff. It was not fully automated, I've already covered, simply because chef doesn't mandate, or Ansible or any of these tools don't mandate that it has to be fully automated. There's a workaround and that is manual. It would take hours to deploy, right? So if, for example, something went down and you have to reprovision it, it would take many hours before the server would come back up. If a whole region went down, or if you have to provision a new region, right? A new setup, it would take maybe days, like 3 to 7 days for us to kind of provision that. If a service went down, so if you have multiple services running, and if a service went down, right, you would have to go back into the app, ship a new version or change the config to say don't use that server, because that service is no longer live. And for that duration, which could be 15 minutes, could be an hour, you would see downtime on that service, right, or it's usage. Finally, the stuff that was actually running had never been tested in production really. Because what it was some original thing that you built, and then end chef runs over that. Right? So the end state, now nobody really knows. It's an implied kind of state, it's not very clear what it is. And it's not really been tested, right? It just goes into production, and over time you kind of discover what problems it has. So it's not very testable. Also, it's very difficult to revert to the last known good state, because you don't know what is last known, right? It's not explicit. What is last known? Because I could have made a manual entry change, you could have, a chef run could have made a change, right? So on and so forth. So it's very, very difficult. This is what is wrong with this world. It's very painful. We spent very long nights, you know, just struggling and trying to figure out how to keep the software up and running, right, for our customers. So a lot of you have probably seen this, right? This is how it felt. Very popular GIF. This is what our life was like. So, this is keeping production up and running. The train is a production. I have a follow-up, you can see it. It was very creative, right? And you have to do this kind of stuff. So, every DevOps guy, he gets that moment, right? He says, I know how to do this. It'll start working, right? And so, that was our life. So the question is, how do we now build a bullet train one, right? We have this broken railway system which doesn't really work. Life is risky, everybody's putting their lives on the line. So now how do we build a bullet train one? So now let's look at the new, right? So now you understand, appreciate the problem with the old. Now let's look at what this new world is doing. Let me start by telling you what is immutable infrastructure. Once you understand that, you will have a framework in your head as to where to fit all the information that I'm going to send out. So immutable infrastructure is just these some definitions of explaining what immutable infrastructure is. So one thing is that you build a server only once and it never mutates, immutable, never changes. So if you built it once and it has some flaw in it, you need to provision a fresh server. Right? You can't modify this old one. Everything is disposable, right? So, because you can't modify it, there's no way of reusing it. So you have to dispose of it. There is no can't get in to that server because you're not allowed to modify it. So what will you do with this? Want to read logs? You can send logs to people. So this is an immutable infrastructure. Is a world where servers are built once and you don't touch them in any way. You stop thinking of your servers as pets, right? You don't give them nice names like Tony, right? Because you don't want a relationship with that server anymore. The moment you want to change it, you're going to go ahead and connect. So you think of it as cattle, right? This is a very famous analogy for saying this. So cattle is essentially, the problem with cattle is, the way you handle cattle is that whenever some animal in a herd falls sick, right? You shoot that animal and you kind of reuse whatever resources come out of that animal and you don't worry about it. You don't have a relationship with it. Right? With pets, how you name your servers is you call it something fuzzy or nice, like Naruto or something, and then I know Naruto is down and I'll go and fix Naruto and that doesn't happen. So in this world, you have cattle, you don't have pets. Okay? Now let's look at what happened to our Kayako instance, how it was made earlier and how it's made now. Okay? Once we've implemented immutable infrastructure, then I'll talk about the implementation later. So earlier we got a request from a form, we still get that request, it just goes to a more modern piece of code, it doesn't go to that old legacy app. There is no getting a list of all servers anymore. There is no more copying code from one directory to another. Right? Now the configuration is now not stored on each of the 20 servers. It's stored in one key value store, which I'll introduce later. It's called console. There is no need to send an ACK because none of that work is done anymore. There is no need to execute a product setup because the way we do it now, we prepare we have pre-prepared instances that we keep ready for your trial well before you've asked or requested for one. So we just use a pre-prepared instance. And there's no need for a DNS entry, that's a minor point. So you see a lot of steps have been eradicated. And so that this kind of now reduces down to this. So with three steps, there's less likelihood of having failure and having problems, right? With 8 or 10 steps, there was more likelihood. And what are those three steps? Get a request to make a trial, update the configuration in a key value store, and that's it, use a pre-prepared instance, right? But how did we achieve this? I'll talk a little bit about achieving this. Now imagine you have this code set up and you have to do stuff, right? What's one of the first things that you want to do? So every time you have to make a server, you have to put some software on it, right? So you need to make an image, okay? In the immutable infrastructure world, you need to make an image that you will install on that server. You can do this in various ways. We have chosen to use Hashicorp, which is a lovely software company, which is providing a bunch of solutions for DevOps. So they have four or five tools that we've used almost all of them, and I'll share that with you. So they have a tool called Packer, right? And you can Google for this, Hashicorp Packer. And Packer will kind of help you automate the image creation process. So how do you create an image? You can use something like Chef, Ansible, Shell scripts, whatever you want, and you feed that into Packer essentially. And then Packer will generate that image for you. And it will also push that to AWS. So that it's available as an AMI. So one of the changes we made from moving from that old infrastructure to this new one is we started using AWS. Okay? So we're no longer using software. And we make an image just like we would with Chef or Ansible or whatever else. And we would then make an AMI of it. And that AMI would get pushed to AWS. We also made the other change. We said all our applications will Dockerize. Right? And that same Docker environment is the Docker environment that the developer installs to develop. So we said, whatever development you're doing, you're going to do in a Docker environment, and we'll use the same environment without any changes and ship it all the way, right? So we did that. So your development experience is exactly like production. There is no difference. You will not discover a bug because your development experience was different and where it is installed is different. So we use Docker to do that. Now Docker also needs its images built, right? Because what you do is you commit your code to a GitHub repository, let's say, right? So GitHub has a post-commit hook. That hook will essentially hit the CI tool that we use. It's called Drone. And it's really good for the Docker ecosystem and you can try it out. It's try.drone.io or .org. And what that does is it'll use your Docker file to essentially make a fresh Docker image with that latest commit, right? right, that you just created. And it will move it, we use ECR, the registry that AWS provides for keeping all your images, right? You can also use Docker Hub. So we push our Docker image that we've just committed there. So first thing we needed to get to this new world, or if you go and apply this back at your workplaces, first thing you need to do is get your images right, right? This is how you do it. You go use something like Packer to generate an image, generates an AMI, puts it on AWS, use something to generate latest Docker images when code is updated, right? You need these two components. Next thing you need is you need hardware to put that software on, right? These images you've generated, now you need hardware for that. So we use another lovely tool that these guys have, it's called Hashicorp Terraform, right? And it's like cloud formation, but with none of the pain. So if anybody has used AWS cloud formation, you know people used to say that XML sucks and JSON is awesome. And then when you use cloud formation, you say XML sucks and JSON sucks. Right? Because you write so much JSON when you use cloud formation, it's like, oh god. So what Hashicorp does is obviously they felt the pain also. So they have written a more concise key value kind of syntax called HCL that you can use to kind of describe this. So that's an example of that. So here what we are doing is, we are saying we need an ELB. This is just a simple screenshot. We are saying we need an ELB. We want to call it front end. It's going to be a load balancer for us. The ELB on AWS takes the following settings, right? It needs to know what code it's running, what protocol it's running, so on and so forth. So you give it those settings. You also say how many instances you want of this server, right? And what AMI you want to use, and what size of an instance you want. You write this in code, right? You write this, you commit this to your Terraform repository, you make a GitHub repository, you commit it there. Now, whenever you want a fresh ELB, you will run Terraform apply, and it will go there, check your current state, see if you already have the 5 ELBs you need. If you do, it won't do anything. But let's say you have only 2 ELBs and then you will change this number to 5 and run it. It would then add 3 more ELBs. So that's infrastructure as code. As opposed to going to AWS console, saying add a new ELB and then manually configuring it, you do it like this. So now when you have to scale tomorrow, how long does it take to scale to add 15 more ELBs? A lot of time, well, not in this. You just change that 5 to 15, press enter, say Terraform apply, new ELBs are up and running, right? And this is not restricted to simple things like ELBs. All of AWS can be configured with this, right? Almost all. So you can configure security groups, NACLs, VPNs, everything. And it's all in code. So if a new guy joins your company and you don't have much documentation, he can go and read this to understand exactly how everything connects to everything else, right? Now, if two people have to file an ELB in the company, it won't be any different. There's no risk of it being different. There's no chance of it being different. It's going to be configured exactly the same way, right? So it's standardized now. Terraform allows you to preview your changes. So when you run Terraform apply, it can tell you this is what will change. Do you want to go ahead with this, right? So you can see, oh, this is what it's going to do, right? And then you can approve it. So it's very safe. You can collaborate, so you can commit your Terraform code into a repository. And then a bunch of you can work together, you know, to get infrastructure up and running. And that wasn't possible earlier. The only way of collaborating earlier was you were sitting and a guy sitting next to you. He said, let's do it like this. Or I know we know we should do it like this. And so on and so forth. That was the only form of collaboration. Now, if I want to make an ELB, I'll do this ELB and I'll give it to Gufran, say. And say, hey, Gufran, this is how I think the ELB should be. He said, no, you're missing, you know. You want to kind of add this configuration as well. You want to add these other things. It will all happen in code before I end the collaboration. I'll commit and then when I run it, it will be up and running perfectly. Right? It's also modular. So you can write a configuration for a web server which runs Nginx and PHP, say, and then anybody can use it. It's not limited to your company. Right? So you have modules. It also gives you environment parity. So now you can make your staging environment. Same thing, smaller instances, lesser instances, just change the size or the number, the cost aspect, but you can get exactly the same environment with the same SG, same NACL, same VPN, all of those rules being exactly the same, right? So that's Terraform. You have very little time, but I'll kind of speed this up. So now you've got the image that you want to install on the hardware and you know how to get your hardware up in a reliable fashion. because we dockerized, right, and even if you didn't, even for normal service, you need something that's going to manage all your containers. So what happens when you're running multiple applications is that you might have servers which have unutilized capacity, right? And you just pay for it without ever using it. So what Nomad does, Nomad is the next tool in the Hashicorp schedule. What that does is essentially schedules your hosts, right, and manages them. So it will decide when and where to run a certain service. If it feels that a certain host is empty and it could take another instance of the service, it will run it there for you. Right? So you give it a fleet of hardware and it essentially manages all the Docker deployments or even non-Docker deployments for you. It has three kinds of tasks or jobs that it does. Okay? It calls them services, system, and batch jobs. So you can tell Nomad to do a service job. What that means is that it will decide where your service is running. So where whatever job, let's say you want to run a certain application, right? So you'll configure it as a service job, and then Nomad will decide in the cluster where it's going to run. Okay? You tell it, you give it some constraints. I need so many instances, or I need so much CPU, and so on and so forth. And then it'll go and choose where to run it on which hardware. So you no longer have to think about which piece of hardware you have to run it on. System jobs are very similar to service jobs, except that they must run on the set of nodes that we've chosen for sure. One instance must run compulsorily. So with a service, it's possible that an instance is not running on one box at all, but it's running on another box, right? But with a system job, it's going to run on each box. So we use system jobs for that, and then there are batch jobs. Batch jobs are, for example, if you want to execute a shell command, right? You come up with a batch job and you give it to Nomad. Nomad will then just go ahead and execute it for you on any of the servers that it feels fit. And how you describe all of these jobs is using a JSON-like format, essentially. And you go ahead and tell it, you know, what command you want it to run, what resources it should use, so on and so forth, and then Nomad does all the scheduling. So you specify the constraints. Nomad helps you kind of improve efficiency. And in our case, it also helps us do blue-green deployments, right? So what Nomad does for us is whenever we ship new code, a hook hits Nomad when a new deployment happens. And then Nomad will say, okay, I need to deploy, and we've told it to use a blue-green strategy. So it generates 5 new servers. The old 5 servers are still receiving traffic, right? Generates 5 new servers, waits for them to go green. So they have health checks, they grow green. Once they go green, it switches the traffic from these 5 servers to these 5 servers, then takes these 5 servers down. Thus, blue-green deployment is an immutable infrastructure without any doubt. Okay, once you've got all of this set, you also need to worry a little bit about configuration and secrets. So configuration is easy, you can store it on any key value store. I'll introduce that later, but secrets you can store on a tool offered by Hashicorp called Vault. What Vault does essentially is secrets management. It allows you to safely and securely keep your secrets and to programmatically access them. So you put all your tokens and everything only in Vault. You don't put them on every server, you don't put them in a chef data bag. There's no chance of the surface area for the threat is reduced. Obviously, all Hashicorp tools work with each other. So Vault kind of integrates naturally with Nomad. So what happens is that first, we have a thing called console business services coming, which is on the next slide. That comes up, and then Vault comes up when we create a new region. So then Vault comes up, and Nomad comes up in parallel and wait for Vault to become ready. And when Vault is ready, Nomad looks for a role and profile defined for it. So it gets that from Vault, it gets all the credentials it needs. Then it creates custom roles and profiles for each application. So if you have a certain service which only needs access to, say, one third-party service and needs your token, Nomad will provision that and give it that, and that will run. So it does all of that. What will kind of help do all of that? In our case, for example, it will also creates IAM users for us. So if a service needs an IAM user, it will automatically kind of create it for you and you can use it. Okay, it also does encryption as a service. We don't use that, but that feature is available. Encryption as a service is this general idea that you have Vault up and running, you give it any data, right, it keeps all the certificates on its side, and it gives you the encrypted data back that you can use to ship anywhere. We don't use that, but it's also available. I'm running out of time, so I'm rushing this. You guys can ask more questions later. So then this console, this is the fifth and the last component that we use. One of the problems was if a service went down, we wouldn't know that the service has gone down, right? So what console does for us is service discovery. So you may have heard of Zookeeper. Zookeeper does something similar. Console service discovery is available both on DNS and HTTP. So if you have a service running on some DNS endpoint like service.kayako.com, let's say, you query that, make that DNS query, it returns all the IPs for you on which that service is running, and you can connect to any of them, right? And if a service goes down, its health checks will fail, and it will automatically be removed from the DNS server. So now when your application is running, it queries again, it gets that only these four IPs are available, one is not available, so it only uses those. So service discovery becomes completely automated and can be used in your application. Also provide the key value store. So earlier we used to have a configuration for each tenant, for everybody. So InvestorPad, when they did a trial with us, we give them a custom configuration saying they are on a free plan, and then they decide to pay, and we kind of update that configuration, right? So all of that is now stored on console. And it offers a key value store, a very simple key value store that you can access via HTTP. We store that configuration there, it's in one place. Now you don't have to go to each server and get it. Every server rises up, has a normal console agent running on it, which helps you query and get all the configuration details it needs, right? You can also do runtime configuration. We no longer do this, we move even ahead. But what you could do, for example, is every time you add a load balancer, right? Let's say you want to add Nginx rules. So when a load balancer comes in automatically, it registers with console as a load balancer, right? Then there's a tool called console template that is listening to console and says, oh, new load balancer has come up. I need to make, a new upstream server has come up. I need to make entries into a load balancer, right? So it will go and modify the Nginx configuration file on all the existing servers, right? And that would happen automatically. That was a bit mutable for us. So we moved on from this and we now do completely DNS-based lookup from this, but I'll not cover that right now. A little bit short in time, but that's how we use console, right? That's a screenshot showing you essentially services which are green and so on and so forth, right? And it tells you how it's doing on the network, what the health status is, so on and so forth. Okay, so quickly to wrap this up, so that was all of Hashicorp that we used, right? So now what you've got is you've got images made, you know how to get hardware up, you can put it on that hardware, you can manage your secrets, you can manage your configuration. And you can do live discovery of services, right? You can do all of this host of stuff with just Hashicorp. But all of this wouldn't really be possible or practical to do without having a cloud provider. And so we use AWS, right? And if you remember the components that we used to use earlier, all of them got replaced by AWS components, which are highly available, completely managed, so we don't have to worry about it. So if you notice, we had Beanstalk in AWS. Now we just use SQS. It works for our use case. Elasticsearch is no longer provisioned or run by us. There's an Elasticsearch service that AWS provides. So we just tell Terraform make an Elasticsearch service cluster with three servers. It's done. That's the total amount of effort we have to make. The same goes for Redis, Elastic Cache service. MySQL, we use Aurora, which is a variant, managed variant of MySQL that AWS provides. And instead of Direct, now we use Route 53, which is also programmatically available and gives a whole host of other. So all of this would have been possible. You can't do this with software. You have to be on a cloud provider. It can be any cloud provider. We've had really good experiences with AWS. So that's the number of components we have used, and all of these are not managed by us. They're managed by AWS. So all of that overhead is gone forever. You don't have to worry about it. So that's how you build a bullet train model. That's what we thought we did. Questions? I know I cannot rush through this because we're out of time. We have a few minutes for questions. Yes. So you can, so Terraform, for example, you can write your script to run on any provider. So you can write an AWS, Google, so on and so forth. It doesn't matter. You can just change the provider and the script to more or less do that. So yes, it is. Any other questions?
Does it support for multiple providers?
Yeah, it does. It supports. From what does it support? It supports
Azure,
AWS,
Google.
Does it provide support concurrently for two
providers? Yeah, you can put anything in your script. You can provision across multiple products. Any other questions? URL called Kayako.org, bit.ly/Kayako.org. You can go and hit that. It's an example of how somebody could build an app in the Kayako network now. It's 5 minutes of video. It's sped up. Probably takes 10 to 12 minutes in reality to do this. But in 10 to 12 minutes, you can write an app in Kayako and get it up and running on the cloud in no time. Okay? So that's a demonstration of how all of this comes together to help developers. Cool. Thank you so much, folks.
Thanks a lot, Kashif. That was super informative. And.